Hello everyone, it's Paola. Welcome back to my channel. Today I have Karen with me. Say hello.
Hello.
And we are going to talk about Schmigadoon. So if you don't know, Schmigadoon is a musical TV comedy series on Apple TV, and it's starring Cecily Strong and Michael Keegan Key, and they're a couple. And they're going through a little bit of a rough patch. So Cecily Strong's character, her name is Melissa, she suggests that they go on this like couples retreat to like strengthen their relationship. And then they get lost and they stumble upon this little town called Schmigadoon, which is a parody of the town called Brigadoon, which is a musical. And it's a lot of fun. I don't know what Karen thinks, but I had a ton of fun with the first two episodes out.
Yeah, I did too. It was super fun. I honestly cannot say that I'm familiar with the actual musical Brigadoon, so I don't know how much there was. Like, do you know that show at
No.
all? Yeah, I don't either. So I feel like there could have been a lot of like direct references from Brigadoon that I did not catch. Probably more than just the name.
Yeah, same. I looked it up. I think it's also about a musical town, kind of like a Groundhog Day musical town.
Okay.
Maybe we should watch it and then...
compare. They also had like the opening credit sequence was like the images, which I saw the creator of the show posted on Twitter that they were actually like paper images that they like created. Which is like how they did it like back in the old like movie musicals. So it wasn't like a computer generated like opening credit sequences. Like they have like the actual title cards, which I thought was really cool.
Yeah, I also really like that. It just immediately tells you what you're going to see.
I have to say that like honestly, one of my biggest criticisms of it is that like the cast is too good and like, but like they don't like utilize them very much. Ariana DeBose is in like one tiny scene from what we saw in the first two episodes.
Yeah,
like there's just like so many talented people and the episodes are so short, like you hardly even get to see them. Is it Jaime Camille is the in like the, he's like credited as like part of the main cast, but I never even saw him at all. Like Fred Armisen said like one line.
Yeah, and not even in the like in the opening when they go, when they sing Schmigadoon, because I thought he was going to be Cecily Strong's new love interest. So
maybe I feel like they might kind of like date a bunch of different people.
Yeah, that would be fun. I would love to see that, because yeah, it's very stereotypical of it's a parody, so it's a very like the archetypes are there, so I love it. In the first episode I wrote that it's immediately like magical and funny because of the vending machine thing and the anniversary thing when the waitress just opens the tray and all of this candy falls out. So I love
actually
that.
Thought that was so cute.
Yeah, I thought it was so sweet. I don't know how they shoot. I think pretending to go from being like madly in love with someone to like on the verge of breaking up and then eventually breaking up, I think that's hard, both in the writing and for the actors. And I really bought it. I really buy that Michael Keegan Key and Cecily Strong are in a not so happy relationship after meeting so sweetly.
It's actually like interesting how basically the premise of the show is like kind of exploring the idea of like, they're like, oh, I love you, so we're in love. But it's like you can like love somebody and not like be in love with them. And like the dynamic of like a relationship not having like that like special like feeling to it, how like you can just become like in a rut like that. It's very like on the nose, but it is fun to like watch that dynamic. And like I'm interested to see how it plays out, because I feel like, I mean, this is just my guess, I feel like they're probably going to fall back in love and then like leave together, you know. Mm-hmm. Like I would be surprised if the show ended a different way, but yeah, we'll see.
Yeah, that would make sense, because I don't know if they're planning to like expand it, but I feel like if it just stayed the one season with them two, I feel like that would be...
I don't really know exactly what they have planned, but my guess is they're not going to do a second season because, like I said, like the cast is just like so talented and there's so many people in it. I could not imagine this cast getting back together, like especially like after COVID, because like theater has been shut down, which is why a lot of these actors are free. So it's like when Broadway opens back up, like they're not going to be able to like get the same people. You know what I mean?
Have to get stuck in another musical with another
kid. Yeah. I was going to point out that the main chorus is like all the same people in all the scenes. My guess at least is that like most of the people in that chorus like are from Broadway because they're all just like very technically like talented at dancing and singing. But I thought it was really cool that it's like only from two episodes, like I'm already starting to recognize the chorus members. And like, I feel like they get more screen time, honestly, than anybody else in the show.
Yes. I loved in the opening number that we got to see. I know you don't watch Drag Race, but we see Peppermint, and I love Peppermint.
Yeah. Well, I know Peppermint from Head Over Heels.
Oh, she was in it?
I think that was the first like trans lead on Broadway ever, was in Head Over Heels.
Oh, that's cool. I'm gonna definitely look up like a bootleg or highlights.
Yeah, but I did notice that too. I was like, why was Peppermint there for 1 second and then gone?
Yeah, I need to see more of everyone, honestly. I love the direction that it's going right now, but I wish that at least in these first two episodes that they like tried a little harder with, you know, trying to solve their relationship issues. And that was how we got introduced to, you know, the rest of the cast and got to see a little bit more of them as opposed to them doing their own thing.
Yeah. I feel like this is moving really fast, 'cause I think there's only going to be 6 episodes in the whole season, which is, I feel like, not enough to develop the plot at all.
Oh no, I got so sad. I thought they were going to get like 8 or 10, like in every other streaming platform.
Did they have been moving the plot forward like very fast? Like they broke up and then immediately just like go start dating other people.
Yeah.
Like you guys have been dating for like 4 years.
Yeah. Like how do you just do that? I really like that they, again, that immediately they go into like the parody aspect of it. Like when Kristen Chenoweth says the racist thing, like, oh, quite a cute exotic couple. Like, I feel like that's how, I mean, the theater has been for a really long time that they're like, it's not welcoming of people of color, but also like the Ariana DeBose is in it.
Yeah. They had like kind of like a one-off line where like, she was like, oh, but it's like a theater company with like colorblind casting. So like, I feel like, yeah, it's, there are like complicated things there. 'Cause on the one hand, obviously it's better to like, not be like, let's keep this exactly how classic musicals are and just not cast any people of color in our TV show, because that would just be absurd. But it is also just like kind of like okay to be like, oh, it's just a theater company and they did colorblind casting and it's like, that's just how the world is, we're not going to talk about that anymore, like there are no implications at all.
Also, like Aaron Tveit looks absolutely delicious, like I just could not.
He's so funny. Well, kind of going off what you said about like Kristen Chenoweth's character is just like the trope of like, you know, classic musical theater. Like I wrote down that his brain like has musical theater logic, because like Aaron Tveit's character just like fully thinks the way like a character in a musical thinks. Like he's like, I don't remember what the line was, but he's like talking to Cecily Strong's character and he's like, you know, get away from me, I have my urges now. And like, he's like, I need to leave. It's just like, it's like nobody ever talks like that, but it's like the way that he thinks like is purely like in that box of like what musical theater characters think, like at least like obviously the classic. Like,
yeah, I also like that it doesn't sound too auto-tuned, because I know you watch High School Musical, the series. And what I hate about that show is that every song you can hear that there's been work done. But in Schmigadoon, it doesn't sound too much like it.
No, you're correct, because I read like from the creator of the show, he was also talking about that, most of the songs are just like sung on set, like recorded there, like live.
Oh,
because I didn't realize that. They did a really good job with that. Yeah, like everyone sounded natural and sounded really good, but I didn't realize that it was like recorded like live.
Oh, also, I haven't seen many classic movie musicals, but I love that corn pudding song had a little like innuendo there. Like if he wants to taste my corn pudding, he has to, like we have to get married. I'm like, this show is, what is happening? I just thought it was so funny.
The corn pudding song is really funny to me. I feel like it has to be parodying something specific, and I wasn't totally sure what. My first thought was the clam bake song from Carousel, because it like Carousel, they just like randomly start singing about having a clam bake. So it's like sort of that vibe where they're just like, we're just a, you know, a little small town and we're singing about our food.
And I love that Keegan-Michael Key is not like so out of it. He's just like, nope, this is absolutely.
But you know, he's gonna end up singing at some point. I'm very excited for whenever that happens.
I thought he was going to in the second episode when he goes on a date with Dove Cameron's character, which was like, oh boy. Maybe we should talk about that, because I mean, the first episode went by so quickly, like I didn't even notice that it was 30 minutes.
Honestly, the first episode is kind of a blur to me, because it was just like introducing everyone. Mm-hmm. I feel like not a lot actually happened besides obviously them going there and realizing they were stuck. But the second episode was a little bit, had more of like an actual plot. Oh yeah. Episode 2 starts out with that song about like men and women fighting and they're like, yeah. And he says this, and then they're like, they're actually arguing. I thought that was funny.
The song starts, it's like, oh, and then you give her a smack. And I'm like, I guess society has come a long way.
The heteronormativity of that song was like very strong. And then I immediately start thinking like, are there gay characters in this musical? And then it like immediately goes to Alan Cumming and they're like, are you gay? He's like, oh, you know, maybe. So we'll see how that pans out. But yeah. It was immediately a question that I had. And then the show answered it right away.
I thought they were going to be heteronormative as well, like the modern characters, the real life characters. But then she's the one who's like, oh, are you? Because I don't think this is for me.
I think that's good though, because like they kind of need to question everything that's going on within the world. Well, one question that I have is money and commerce. Because everything is so cheap and they're like, yeah, I'll pay, you know, 2 cents for this. And I'm like, but where do these people get their money?
Right.
Yeah. It's not explained. Also, are Cecily Strong and Keegan-Michael Key like going to run out of money? What are they going to do?
Exactly. Because apparently they have a lot of money for the 1800s or whenever this is set. But still, like, they don't use it wisely.
I know. I was like, dude, you can win the auction with $2. Why are you dropping the full 20?
Right.
You don't have any other way to get money.
Exactly. Also, I have a small comment on Dove Cameron's character. I mean, Dove Cameron looks young. When Cecily Strong's character goes like, oh, have fun with your little teenager. And Keegan-Michael Key goes like, she's not a teenager. And I'm like, but dude, like, don't you, like, how, I don't know. I feel like that's something that you can tell. Sometimes, like, it's very rare that an actual teenager looks 25, because there's, like, a tree that symbolizes, like, how old she is. She says that her dad planted that tree when she was 14, and the tree is, like, really small. So I'm assuming she's, like, 16, 17, maybe. But again, once again, I feel like you know in the way that she, like, carries herself.
I don't know. Like, I think that the joke was, like, he realized it was bad. He was like, oh no, I'm not cool with this situation, which is like, okay, good. If you like actually think about it, it's like, dude, why did you not ask? Like, why was this not one of your first thoughts, like your first questions? Come on. Like,
right?
You know, and like it's just like, it's very cheap, because she's kind of acting like, oh, I'm ready to like get married or whatever. So I think in their world, it's like, oh, she's 18. Like, she's an adult. It's time for her to get married off. But yeah, obviously, like, this man is like, I don't know how old they're supposed to be, like late 30s or something.
Yeah, maybe. Oh, I wrote, but now I don't know what it means. I wrote, is Kristen Chenoweth gonna make them fall in love? Does she know the caveat? Like, does she, like, is she aware
that
they
Oh,
can?
I don't think you're supposed to think about it too hard because it's,
Yeah.
you know, it's a musical and it's just fun and it's like magical. But I do like what sort of awareness do the characters in this town have of like the outside world? Or
Yeah.
like how many other people like from outside have ever like come in before? Because we know that they don't have the awareness that they're in a musical. Because like Aaron Tveit sang that song, and Cecily Strong's character was like, "That was a beautiful song." He was like, "What are you talking about? I wasn't singing." So like it is like that where you know they're just living their lives, and it's not supposed to be a literal musical. Yeah, it's not like they're like weirded out that they came and showed up. Like they're like, "Oh,
Exactly.
hi, stranger! Like, welcome to our town."
Maybe it is, in fact, after all, a theater production. We don't know.
I did notice the when she was in the forest with Alan Cumming, like they had like a forest backdrop that you could see, which I thought was really, really funny. And I just liked that it was just further creating like this is a musical, like this is a stage production, like it's not actually real.
Oh, I also love that the when Aaron Tveit buys Cecily Strong's like pudding or basket.
Yeah.
Yeah. And they go on a date and she's like, "Oh, are you gonna win for the stuffed animal for me?" And he's like, "No, you said you were a strong woman. You can win it for yourself." I thought that was so funny.
Yeah, he actually seems a lot like cooler than he first appears. 'Cause he's kind of like he's like the bad boy of the town, but it's like a bad boy to that town is like he has a lot more like independence and like forward thinking than like the rest of them. So I actually like started to like him a lot more, and I was like, okay, I actually could see them like as a match.
I actually thought it was kind of funny that Cecily Strong is the one that wants to fight for her relationship, but then she's like, "You know what? Screw it. I'm gonna make out with this blonde boy and see where it goes." And then Keegan-Michael Key, who's the one that's like, "Eek, I want to get out of here, whatever mean by whatever means necessary." He's the one who's like falling on his face.
I think Ariana DeBose is going to end up being a love interest for him.
Ooh.
I don't know like how far that's going to go. Again, only 4 episodes left for us to watch.
I'm so sad.
I don't know how they're going to do that.
Why did they get such a little season?
I mean, it could have been scheduling was really hard, but it also could have been like they only had so much budget.
Yeah, because also like musical things like this have not been done. Like not even like Glee is not a fair comparison.
Okay, let's talk about other musical TV shows because I have been like thinking about them and comparing them in my head a lot because I like am obsessed with the idea of a musical TV show, so I will watch like any of them. And I was so into Glee when Glee first came out because it was like I had nothing else. I was like I wanted a musical TV show so bad. It's just not a good show. But it was like one of the first like musical TV shows, and it was like one of the only things that I like had as a baseline. And now there's like other examples. For me, like Crazy Ex-Girlfriend is like top tier for me. And I was thinking about like these two shows in comparison to each other. 'Cause like Crazy Ex-Girlfriend, I will listen to those songs all the time. They're like genuinely good. And I do feel like that is one thing that I was like iffy about with this show was that I loved the songs in the context of the show. Like they're super funny, but I wouldn't just like sit down and listen to like Corn Puddin', you know? Like it's only funny in the show. Like I wouldn't like ever listen to those songs outside of it.
Another musical show that I love is Smash. That's the
Yeah, I was
one
gonna
that
say
I.
Smash, I feel like is for me a step up from Glee.
Yeah.
Because Smash I like still enjoy, but it also I don't think it's super high quality. Like
Yeah,
it's a
no.
mess.
Yeah, no.
But I love it. Gallivant. Did you ever watch Gallivant?
No.
Gallivant is really good. It is it's like kind of a medieval setting, but like very like Renaissance festival-y. It's like not historically accurate at all. And it is about this man named Gallivant, and his girlfriend gets chosen by the king of the land to like be his queen. And So he goes off like on a quest to get her back. It's like very campy. It's really, really funny.
There's also, I don't know if you ever saw it, but Rice.
Oh yeah. I wanted to watch that. I totally forgot about that show. I should do that. But then also obviously High School Musical, the musical, the series, right, we've talked about. I like that as well. And then there's also Zoe's Extraordinary Playlist. I feel like that show is more like Glee, where they just have the characters sing pop songs, mm-hmm, and it's not really like a musical where it's like advancing the plot as much. But back to Schmigadoon, I was going to say, it is like such just like an homage to classic like musical theater. Feels like a lot of people like act like musicals are not cool, but I feel like there, right, is like a market for them. That's, mm-hmm, like people like musicals, and like that's why these shows exist.
I mean, I wish people would give it a shot.
I'm pretty sure that anybody would watch this and like,
yeah,
get it.
I don't know where it's going. Again, I have the question of Kristen Chenoweth's character, like, does she know? Like, is she the evil mastermind? Like,
that's actually a really interesting idea, that it's like she's like knows more about the town than anybody, mm-hmm, else. Now I am wondering if like the show is going to end with like way more like to it than I originally was thinking, because I was originally thinking like they're going to go on this journey, they're going to fall back in love and like be able to leave because like their relationship will be better, mm-hmm, but I wonder if like it's going to end up like the Good Place, where it's like everything gets like off the rails chaotic and like the whole, mm-hmm, like town just collapses because like they realize that it's like not real.
Right? Like that's so, that would be a very interesting take on it. And also I just had a small theory concerning Alan Cumming, like right back to the star-studded cast. Maybe Jaime Camille could be his love interest.
That's a good idea. Also, on talking about Kristen Chenoweth's character, I do actually find it kind of weird that they decided to go down the route of like her being like so overtly religious, because, yeah, I feel like that's not actually like something that's in a lot of musicals. Like those like values, yes. I don't know. I find it to be invoking religion in a way that's like not necessary. Like it could have just been like she's like the town judge and is like, here's the laws, oh, of our town, which to me would have made more sense in terms of like actually parodying musical theater, where, mm-hmm, the classic like musicals, they just have like everyone is like, we follow these values.
Oh, and I also like a little like extra thing that I really loved was when Cecily Strong was getting her song and she was like, oh my god, this is my song, oh, it's even in my key and everything.
That, and how she just like knows automatically like what to sing and like, mm-hmm, the melody of it. Mm-hmm. I think that's really fun. And I'm also just like knowing that, like that's how the world works. I'm like, when will Keegan-Michael Key sing a song?
I cannot wait to see where it goes. I'm very excited.
Yeah.
Okay, we're going to wrap up here. Again, we're both very excited to where this is going. Thank you, Karen, for joining me. Thank you, all of you, for watching. Next episode will be recapped on Karen's channel, so I will leave a link to that down below so that you can check us out there. Thank you so much for watching. If you haven't already and you'd like to, go ahead and hit subscribe, and we will see you next week, next episode on Karen's channel. Bye.